Hello friends. So students, today we shall discuss about some properties of alpha rays. So we shall be discussing how to calculate the velocity and energy of alpha particle. We shall discuss here today the range of alpha particles, how we calculate the range of alpha particle, and then we shall see what is Giger-Nuttall law. So in this module, we are first starting with the velocity and energy of alpha particles. So, as you all know that alpha particle is a helium nucleus. Helium nucleus consists of two protons and two neutrons. Whereas the helium atom will be consisting of the helium nucleus consisting of two protons and two neutrons and surrounding two electrons. So, alpha particle is a helium nucleus consisting of two protons and two neutrons. So, since it is its nucleus is carrying two protons and two neutrons, so it is massive nucleus and the velocity of the alpha particle is less as compared to that of a electron or a beta particle or a positron. So, to calculate the velocity, we have taken an instrument called the magnetic spectrograph. In the magnetic spectrograph, we have a source S which emits alpha particle, and the assembly of the magnetic spectrograph is placed such that the magnetic field is applied perpendicular to the plane of paper. So when magnetic field is applied perpendicular and the particle is moving in a perpendicular magnetic field, then the charged particle always deflect and they trace a circular path. So the alpha particles will move in a circular path. And we have placed slits S1 and S2 to collimate the beam such that the scattering is minimum. They are moving in a circular path, but they could be deviated from the circular path. So we have inserted these slits so that the path of the alpha particles remain circular. So when they are moving in a circular path under the applied magnetic field, they would produce its existence on the photographic plates. So when the alpha particles will move to the other end where we have kept the photographic plates, so we can record at what velocity they are striking the photographic plate and we can measure the velocity. So this whole assembly is the magnetic spectrograph. So since the alpha particle is moving in the magnetic field which is applied perpendicular to the plane, so the magnetic force applied on the alpha particles will be given by F is equal to Q into V cross B. Since V and B, the direction between the velocity and the magnetic field are perpendicular to each other, so VB sine theta will be VB sine 90 degree and sine 90 is 1. So therefore, our force, magnetic force that will be applied on the alpha particle will be nothing but QVB. And since the alpha particles are moving in a circular path, so there will be a centripetal force also acting on the alpha particles. So this centripetal force will be balanced by the magnetic force. So the centripetal force that is acting on the alpha particle is given by what formula? You all know that it is given by MV square upon R. So mv square by r is balanced by the magnetic force, that is qvb. So qvb is equal to mv square by r, and here v and v gets cancelled, so we can calculate the value of v. So keeping the velocity on one side, we get v is equal to bqr upon m, where v is the velocity. So since q, what is q? Q is the charge on the alpha particle. Since it consists of the helium nucleus consists of two protons, so it is having the two electronic charges. So Q is equivalent to 2e. So one electron charge is 1.6 into 10 raised to power minus 19 coulombs. So Q will be equal to 3.2 into 10 raised to power minus 19 coulombs. And as we have already discussed that the alpha particle is a helium nucleus. So if we know the mass of alpha helium atom and we subtract the two electronic masses, then we get the mass of the helium nucleus, which will be the mass of the alpha particle. So mass of alpha particle is mass of helium atom minus the mass of two electrons that is orbiting in the orbiting shells. So the mass of helium atom in AMU is 4.003873 and the 2 electron in AMU is 0.001098. So taking the difference, we get the value of 4.002775 AMU. And we know that 1 AMU is 1.66 into 10 raised to power minus 27 kilograms. So 4.002775 AMU will be how many kilograms? So it will be multiplied by 1.66 into 10 raised to power minus 27 kilograms. So we get the mass of the helium nucleus or the alpha particle as 6.645 into 10 raised to power minus 27 kg. So now if we substitute the value of Q and M in this equation, so we get V is equal to 3.2 10 raised to power minus 19 BR upon 6.645 into 10 raised to power minus 27. We get 4816 into 10 to the power 4 BR. So by substituting the value of the magnetic field intensity that we are applying and the radius of this circular path that the alpha particle is moving in, so we, if we substitute, we get that the velocity of the alpha particle is nearly equal to 10 raised to power 7 meter per second. So it is moving with quite a high velocity. So since the velocity value is quite high, so we can neglect the relativistic effects. Where in the relativistic effect, if we had to consider the relativistic effect, then we would have considered the mass as m is equal to m naught upon 1 minus v square upon c square, where m naught will be the rest mass and v is the velocity and c is the velocity of light. Since it is a quite a heavy high value, so we are neglecting the relativistic effects. So since now we have calculated the velocity of the alpha particle that is coming out to be 10 raised to power 7 meter per second, and our next part was to calculate the energy possessed by the alpha particle. So the kinetic energy, since the particle is moving, alpha particle is moving, it will possess the kinetic energy due to the virtue of its motion. So kinetic energy is given by half mv square. So we know the value of m. Here we have calculated the value of m and we have calculated the value of velocity also. So substituting the values of the mass and velocity, we get the value of energy in joules as 3.322 into 10 raised to power minus 13 joules. Or if we want to convert it into electron volts, we divide it by a factor of 1.6 into 10 raised to power minus 19. So the energy of alpha particle in electron volts comes out to be 2.076 into 10 raised to power 6 electron volts. And if we want to convert this 10 raised to power 6 electron volt, we can convert it into mega electron volts. So the value of the kinetic energy is 2.076 mega electron volts. So students, you can see that we, from using the magnetic spectrograph, we have calculated the value of the velocity of alpha particle as well as we can calculate the energy of alpha particle. So in this way, we can calculate the velocity and energy. So next, we move on to the calculation of the range of alpha particle. So to calculate the range of alpha particle, here we have chosen a block diagram, an arrangement where this is representing the source of alpha particle. This is the source which would emit the alpha particles, and the whole assembly is a movable where we can move the source ahead and behind. It is a movable block, and here there is a measuring table also which could measure the distance of the source from the chamber, or it could measure that what distance we are moving the source. So this is the scale and the whole assembly is placed on a movable block. Okay students, so here we have kept a collimated slits. So the slits will be collimating the beam of alpha particle, means that it would make the alpha particles to move in a straight line. And this part, this assembly is your ionization chamber. In this ionization chamber, we have filled a gas and the gas is saturated with water vapors. So what happens that when the beam of alpha particles enter into the ionization chamber, since alpha particle is a positively charged, carrying two positive charges, so it has a capacity to ionize the gas through which it passes. So what happens? The gas molecules ionizes as positive and negative centers. And since there would be positive and negative centers in this ionization chamber, and the gas is filled with the water vapors also. So water vapors surround these ions. So water vapors are surrounding these ions, and as the water vapors saturate the ions gradually cool down. So when the ions cool down, they form droplets. So these droplets are photographed in the ionization chamber, and we could record the track through which the droplets are being formed. So the distance up to which the droplets of water are being formed, that distance is noticed or calculated, and the distance at which the ions get saturated and the droplets are being formed, the track is being formed, that distance is called the range of alpha particle. And after a particular distance, we do not see any droplet track, and we see that the alpha particles cannot go penetrate inside the ionization chamber. So what we said, that the alpha beam had passed through the air column and entered the gas chamber. When it entered the gas chamber, it was able to ionize the gas molecules. It created ion pairs, positive centers and negative centers, and the gas was saturated with water vapors. So the water vapors enveloped the ions and formed the droplets. So the droplets were photographed and the tracks were visible at what, till what distance that the droplets were being formed. So the tracks were visible, the distance we calculated up to what distance the formation of the droplets were there, and the distance up to which the droplet was there was the range of the alpha particle. So here we have plotted a graph between the intensity of the ions formed and the distance up to which the ions were formed. So what we see, that on increasing the distance, so as the distance increased, the intensity of the ions formed were increased. Then up to a particular distance, the maximum distance is called the range of the alpha particle, that is represented by R. And after that particular distance, the intensity of the ions gradually decreased, and eventually it ended up to zero. So the maximum distance up to which the intensity was maximum, that distance was called the range. And this distance was measured in centimeter in air at a pressure of 760 millimeter of Hg and a temperature of 15 degree Celsius. So I think you must have understood. Again, we take a recapitulate that what I have written here. That a narrow beam of alpha particle passes through a known thickness of air. Here a narrow beam of alpha particle is passing through the known thickness of air, and it goes through the gas in the ionization chamber. It moves, enters the ionization chamber where the gas is kept, and it ionizes the gas, creates the ion pairs. The gas is then saturated with water vapors. A sudden expansion of gas takes place because ion pairs are created. So the water vapors are enveloping it, and the gas suddenly cools down to get super saturated with vapors, and it condenses, and the vapors condenses on the ions. So when the vapors will condense, it will form a droplet. So the droplets formed along the path of alpha particles are photographed, and the tracks are straight lines, and these tracks end up quickly, means at a particular distance they end up quickly being intensity maximum, and then they gradually decreases. So the tracks decreases after a finite distance, and the distance at which the ionization is taking place, that distance is called the range of alpha particle. So in this way, using this assembly of ionization chamber and the source, we can calculate the range of alpha particle, and from the range also we can calculate the energy, where the formula connecting the range and energy is related by this formula, that range in centimeters is directly proportional to the 3/2 power of E. So if we know the value of the energy of the alpha particle, we can calculate the range of alpha particle, and if we know the range of alpha particle, we can calculate the energy of alpha particle. So in this way, we have two methods to calculate. Either we can calculate the value of energy using the magnetic spectrograph by calculating the velocity and then calculating the kinetic energy, or we can calculate by using the ionization chamber and tracking the record and calculating the range of alpha particle and then using this formula to calculate the energy. So we can calculate the range and energy of alpha particle. So now we come to the most important law of the Giger-Nuttall law. It was given by Giger and Nuttall for the alpha particles. So we had already done in the radioactive series that the radioactive series decay by emitting alpha particles and beta particles, and the series end up from a parent nucleus to a certain daughter nucleus. So we have successive daughters intermediate in this series where they are capable of emitting alpha particles. So if we consider these successive daughter nucleus who are emitting the alpha particles, so we have found that those daughter nuclei which are having quite a high lifetime, or they are longest lived nucleides, so they will be having the least energetic alpha particles. They would emit alpha particles which will have a very low value of energy, and those daughter nucleus which are having low value of the lifetime or least value of the lifetime, they are found to produce very high energy of alpha particles. They are producing high energy alpha particles. So this was a theoretical thing or assumptions that the scientists found, that if the time is large, since time and decay constant or the disintegration constant are inversely proportional to each other, so they found that the longest lived nucleides which are having a least or minimum disintegration constant are having a minimum energetic, or they are releasing minimum energy of the alpha particles. So they found, when they plotted a graph for the radioactive series, they found for all the three radioactive series or for all the four radioactive series, they found that if they plotted a graph between the logarithm of the decay constant versus the logarithming of the range, so they found that the graph was a straight line. All the three radioactive series were having straight line, and their three lines were parallel to each other. So this means that if they are in a straight line, therefore log of lambda is directly proportional to log of range. So the statement was given in 1911 by Giger and Nuttall. It stated that when the logarithm of the disintegration constant is plotted against the logarithm of the range, where the range was calculated in centimeter of air for alpha emitting members in the same radioactive series. So we are calculating the disintegration constant for a particular daughter nucleuses or the parent nucleus which are emitting, capable of emitting the alpha particles. So if we calculated the logarithm of the decay constant of that and calculated the range, then they found that the graph was a straight line. So when the logarithm of the lambda was plotted against the logarithm of R for alpha emitting members in the same radioactive series, and approximately straight line was obtained. So for all the radioactive series, the straight lines were obtained parallel to each other. So since a straight line was obtained, and you know that the equation of straight line is y is equal to mx plus c. So y is what? Y is your log lambda, and this x is your log r, and the slope of the line will be m, and c will be the intercept. So m is the slope. Since all the three series are having the same slope because they are all parallel to each other, So the slope is parallel, so the slope value is same for all the three radioactive series, but obviously they would cut the y-axis or the x-axis at different positions, so the intercept with value will be different. So from this statement they concluded that log lambda is equal to a plus b log ra, where b is the slope and a is the intercept. So b value is the slope of the line, which is same for all the three series, and a is the value of intercept, which will be different for all the three series or all the four series. So here is the value of a and b, and from this range of alpha particles, here only we have done that this range value is dependent upon the energy raised to power 3 by 2. Range is directly proportional to energy. So in this equation, we can substitute the value of Ra. So when we substitute the value of Ra in this equation, so what we get? We get log Ra will be proportional to 3 by 2 log E, which will be proportional to log E. So substituting the value of log E instead of log Ra, what we get? We replace A and B with new constants. So we get log lambda will be equal to K1 plus K2 log E. So what is there? So what we saw here? We saw here that the log lambda is directly proportional to log E. This means that lambda is directly proportional to E. But since lambda is directly proportional, is inversely proportional to T. So this relation means if this is high energy, if this is high energy, then lambda will be high and T will be small. Means that the radioactive series which are short-lived will have high disintegration constant, will release high energetic alpha particles. So that was theoretically suggested that the longest lived nucleides will emit least energetic alpha particles, or the shortest lived nucleides will emit the highest energetic alpha particle. And that is what we are getting from this equation also. So Giga-Nutter law was able to tell that the more the life of the nuclei, it will emit least energy of the alpha particle, minimum energy of the alpha particle. And this was a theoretical assumption of the Giger and Nutter, which was subsequently proved in 1928 by Gurney and Gamow, by using the concepts of wave mechanics or the modern physics, or you can say the quantum mechanics. So quantum mechanically they proved the verification of the Giger-Nutter law. So this Giger-Nutter law is very important, and I think you must have understood the concept. So we'll meet you soon. Thank you.